And already, we'd already gone past our Christmas program time. Nobody's even thinking about the Christmas program anymore. We were already having crowds, you know, 800-900 people. Every night, people receiving the Holy Ghost all over the church. That was my goal. After the Christmas program, we're going to see this happen. God's able to do it now. Our programs won't get it done. I mean, He's not going to stop us if we got something going and we're planning and we're working real hard at it. God will bless it. He's all for it. But if He comes along and He says, well, you've been busy, all right, but I got a way to come to the end of this thing. What it is you're working toward, the goal that you have in your mind, amen. Why don't we just kind of like take a little shortcut? Lay your pencil down. Put your books aside. Put your instruments in their cases. Tell the choir members just to get on their knees for a while. We're going to have a move of God, and that's what you want anyhow. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. But on that Monday night, that one night that we were going to close it, that one night, I forget how many, something like 15 received the Holy Ghost. New people. They started coming in outside the walls. Just started walking in, people we didn't know. Just like they were drawn in. Thank you. I wish I could go on and on. I'm glad I don't have the clock right here right now, but it's just important, I feel like, that we hear again that God, back in those days, whenever it was in your life, whatever He did for you, that you know it was God. He's the God we're serving right now. And He's the God that's going to march into this new year with us. And whatever He ever has done, He is still doing it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And I'll get through it in a minute, but I just felt like, I mean, what else are you going to do on Christmas night besides celebrate Jesus? Everything else pretty much... They all got their minds on something out there, maybe even Jesus. So let's celebrate Jesus for a minute here. Hallelujah. Amen, amen. You ought to be thankful you were born right here where you are and you're able to go to church and do the things you're doing. There were several hundred people on a bridge in the last few hours, on a big bridge in a remote place where it's hard to get to. And they were walking across this bridge to do something that's a little bit different than what we ordinarily do, to celebrate whatever they celebrate. But the bridge collapsed, and at least 100 or maybe 200 or 300, about 500 were on the bridge, and it just broke all to pieces. And they're all, you know, there are a lot of people missing, and over 100 feared dead. Aren't you thankful you were not on that bridge? And if you had your choice to have been on that bridge or hear me talk past 9:30, which would you rather do? Or you could have been in Iraq today when 30-something more people were killed instantly and hundreds injured as a bomb went off right in the middle of them. Which would you rather be doing today? Be there in the hospital or blown to smithereens or be here to hear a little bit more about what happened on that Monday night? Hallelujah. So this thing just, you know, it just got out of my control. Got out of my control. Toward the end of the service, people wonder, what are we going to do? I mean, we had all these new folks that just prayed through. And they were, I still see it in my mind. It was like waves. The crowd, you know, just waves would go through the crowd. It was like waves of water. It just, it's like the wind blowing grass on a, you know, tall grass out in the field. It would start like over here, and it was just a wave of people that would just bow, you know, bend backwards. And I think I saw a picture of what the rushing mighty wind must have been all about. It just seemed like it just filled all the place where people were. Only there weren't hardly anybody standing. They were all sitting. They were all standing where we were. But they would bend over, and it just seemed like it was almost like it was orchestrated. I mean, it was, you know, I've seen Benny Hinn do something similar with his breath, but it wasn't that. It wasn't that. I saw this crowd as it seemed like God was just taking his hand just around the building. You could just see little waves going here and there, and people just falling under the presence of God. And nobody had left. It was like 10 o'clock at night on Monday night, and they were all still there. And again, here came the people with the money. One more night. Just one more night. Now, we got a Christmas program planned. You know, it's just 8 days away. We worked so hard. I'll give 50. They didn't even listen to me. Here's $100. I need this revival. I need what I got. Yeah, right. Nothing changed. Oh, great. Tell them thank you very much. Amen. God's able to do the incredible. While you talk about his blessings, he blesses you. Thank you, Jesus. Let's thank God for that offering that was just sent in. Lord, we praise you for it in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you. Whoever you are, thank you so much. Praise God. Amen. And so this crowd standing there, you know, before I left on Monday night, I had something like $600 or $700 that they wanted me to give to these preachers just to keep them over an extra day. I figured, you know, one more night won't hurt. But I mean, we pretty much got this thing down, Pat. We'll practice, you know, the next night. So I even announced, I said, okay, our next practice for the Christmas program will be Wednesday night. But we'll have one more service tomorrow night. That satisfied the crowd. They took off. Everybody's happy. Tuesday night came, and it was the heart of December time when everybody's got their minds. I mean, even our church people are busy on their jobs, and they're all doing all this stuff, and they can't get free, hardly go to church. But somehow they're wanting to have church. And I'm worried about that Christmas program. Tuesday night comes, and here comes almost twice as many people. The building was just packed. And something like 20 or 30 people got the Holy Ghost. A blind eye, man that had been blind all of his life, started yelling, "I can see!" And he's still able to see today. He's my friend. He lives down in Louisiana. Hallelujah. But when the crowd saw that, it was everything we wanted to do with our Christmas program, it was getting done before the Christmas practice. Hallelujah. And I'll go ahead and wind this down as short as I can. It's so hard to relive this without just going on and on because it doesn't have an end. I mean, there are people all over the world today who came to God during that Holy Ghost revival. That's the revival where a guy came in. I didn't know what I was doing. And that very revival, just a week before when I was worried about my Christmas program, I was worried about this and I was worried about just a few days before. I was worried about this and I was worried about that. And I had all these worries and problems on my mind, how I was going to get this together and that together, organizing all these things. And I was sitting at my desk, just before these two preachers came along, sitting there with my head down, doodling on a piece of paper, drawing a circle, and not having a thought, not knowing what I was going to say to the people. And so I wrote these words, not knowing why I was writing them. I was going the wrong way on a one-way street, and I had to turn around to keep from having a head-on collision. And I wrote those words on a piece of paper, and I didn't know why I wrote them. I was just trying to come up with a thought for the service. This just, bear in mind, this is just a few days before those two preachers showed up. Just a service before, I believe it was. Yeah, the service right before it. And then I wrote, "Rendell Rutledge, you don't have a brain." And then on that word brain, I started circling that with my pencil. You know, like you just sit around and you doodle. You don't have any, you know, you don't really know where you're going with this. So you don't have a thought, so you just kind of draw. And while I was drawing a circle around the word brain, the phone rang.